color guard can begin. Thank you.
Ani, ani, mamin,
Welcome to this year's observance of Yom HaShoah. My name is Sandy Breisacher-Lessig, and I'm a member of the second generation. Perhaps you are here today to remember loved ones or family members you never knew. Perhaps you want to honor the memory of all those who perished just because they were Jewish. Perhaps you knew a survivor who's no longer with us today. Our hearts are heavy with the passing in recent days of Zoli Zamir and Robert Rothschild. Robert's funeral is at 4:00 today at Beth Israel's cemetery at 4 p.m. Zoli's funeral is tomorrow at 1:00 at the Beth Yeshurun Cemetery on Post Oak. Please refer to your program for a list of our beloved Houston survivors who passed away since last year's Yom HaShoah. It's so important to remember that whether confined to ghettos, camps, slave labor, or in hiding, Jews resisted in whatever way they could. Spiritual resistance, cultural resistance, showing concern for others, was as important as armed resistance. And today, we honor that resistance in our readings. Let us keep that precious promise we all make, never to forget, and to live our lives every day as upstanders, not bystanders. We extend a special welcome today to members of the March of Remembrance and to our World War II liberators who have joined us, Chick Havey and Lewis Gammon. Please take a moment now to silence your phones or just simply turn them off. During the service, please hold your applause. Unfortunately, Fred Florsheimer, the survivor scheduled to speak next, had to cancel due to complications from some eye surgery. So we'll proceed next with the invocation by Rabbi Lyon.
On behalf of the congregation, welcome to Beth Israel. This sanctuary serves so many purposes, and for each of us in all of our houses of worship, wherever they may be, and in all the places that we do worship, we remember those who perished from hatred, from xenophobia, anti-Semitism. This day is a day of remembrance and also a day of hope for each of us together. A wise observer once taught, between periods of digging in the dark, we must endeavor always to transform our tears into knowledge. The Jewish people has cried tears of bondage and suffering. They have been marked for genocide and left in heaps of ashes. There isn't a nation or a people on earth that hasn't suffered on its way to becoming great or in its effort to maintain that greatness. The tears that give way to knowledge become the foundation on which the future is built. Our sages taught, Noflim v'omdim, we fall and we rise again. On Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day, we are called together to preserve our relationship to the past and awaken our hope to the future. Only in fellowship can we accept nothing less than the promise that knowledge and understanding will bring us closer to real peace speedily and in our own day. So we pray. Eloheinu ve'Elohei avoteinu v'imoteinu, our God and God of our fathers and our mothers, we have struggled long enough. We know that too many tears have been shed in the world, and too many voices have been silenced that once shouted for freedom. We have learned. Your teachings are a veritable tree of life for those who hold fast to them. They show us ways of pleasantness and guide us along paths of peace. May the lessons we have taken to heart mark a new beginning where joy fills the hearts of all your children, and love binds us in a world of nations dedicated to real peace. May this hour be dedicated to your presence in our life, the memory of your children who perished in the Holocaust, and the covenant that sustains us as a people. Amen.
Why don't you have slaughtered, never knowing the reason why. But whoever treasures freedom, like the swallow, must learn to fly.
Good afternoon. Yom HaShoah in Israel started 4 hours ago. This day and Yom HaZikaron are the only days in which the flags in Israel are lowered half-mast. The religious symbolism of the date chosen for Yom HaShoah is expressed in the fact that it falls on the days of the Omer, which are days of mourning for the people of Israel. Independence Day, which comes a week later, emphasizes the transition of the Jewish nation from Holocaust to survival. Last year, I told the story of my parents. Today, I would like to tell you the stories of my wife's parents. Each of them, as children, survived the Holocaust while fleeing the Nazis towards the Soviet Union. My wife's father's family lived in Poland. When the Germans entered their city, rounding up the Jews in order to send them to concentration camps. My wife's father, Saul, at the tender age of 17, managed to escape and fled eastward to Russia. Tragically, his parents and sister stayed behind and perished in Auschwitz. In Russia, blamed for being a Zionist, Saul was thrown into one of Stalin's gulags for 6 years. There, he witnessed most of his fellow inmates die from the harsh Siberian weather or from being driven to insanity because of the inhumane conditions. Somehow, young Saul managed to stay alive. My wife's mother, Rina, was a 9-year-old child who lived in Leningrad with her mother and younger sister. The girl's father was murdered before the war by the Russian secret police. When the German army marched into Russia, the mother and her two girls were put on the last train to escape besieged Leningrad. The train was bombarded by the German Luftwaffe several times before arriving in the Republic of Kyrgyzstan. There, the family was relatively safe from the Nazis, but lived in vile poverty. After the war, scarred by the hardships of wanderings, Saul and Rina met, got married, made Aliyah to Israel, and established a family. This was their small victory over the Nazis. Last year, we commemorated 75 years of the massacre of Babi Yar, in which German soldiers murdered tens of thousands of Jewish people. Last month, the Russian poet Vladimir Yevtushenko died in Tulsa, Oklahoma. In 1961, he published his famous poem, Babi Yar, which described the massacre. This poem was a protest against the Soviet authorities' attempt to diminish the memory of the murder of the Soviet Jews. Thus, Yevtushenko prompted, for the first time in the Soviet Union, a debate on the Holocaust. He bravely acted for the sake of the Holocaust's memory. Our parents are gone by now. This generation of witnesses to the Holocaust is fading away. We now have the mission, the obligation, to keep the memory of the Holocaust alive with ceremonies like this one today. The memory should live on, also through education and the arts, such as museums dedicated to the Holocaust, and also in plays, poetry, children's books, dance, sculpture, painting, and no less important, by translating the story of the Holocaust into as many languages as possible for the entire world to remember.
Where severe overcrowding, terrible sanitary conditions, and starvation were the norm, cultural and spiritual resistance constituted a form of defiance. Art, literature, theater, poetry, music, and prayer. To create illegally in any camp meant intentionally risking interrogation, torture, camp arrest, or being transferred to the punishment squad, which was the same as being sentenced to death. Still, those trapped in the camps used their talents and their memories to distill some measure of sanity and human sanctity from the chaos and insanity that trapped them. They sought not only the solace, but the strength to carry on, to dare to hope, to record for posterity the agony of their lives, to give some meaning to their suffering, to testify that the will of the human spirit was a flame that could not be extinguished. Ella Stein Weisberger was a child who sang in performances of Brundibar Theresienstadt and lived to tell the story. When we sang, we forgot hunger, we forgot where we were. When we were on the stage, we forgot everything. And when we sang victory songs at the end, we imagined that we overcame Hitler. There was such power in this music. From the diary of teen, Mary Berg from the Warsaw Ghetto on an art exhibition. People seemed to leave the exhibition full of impressions, and even on the street continued to discuss what they saw for a long time. Everyone simply refuses to believe that such works could be produced within the walls of the ghetto, especially under the present conditions of constant manhunts, hunger, sickness, and terror.
My name is Noah Meichler. I'm a third-generation Holocaust survivor. This man right here, Chick Havey, was a liberator of Dachau in April of 1945, and he contributed to liberating my grandfather, Saul Rosenberg. So thank you, Chick. From the diary of Yitzhak Rudashevsky from the Vilna Ghetto in the fall of 1941. In the ghetto, there is devastation. From the hideouts, people emerge like corpses, pale, dirty, with black rings under their eyes. It is getting colder and colder. It's Yom Kippur Eve. People have such a sad high holiday feeling. Nevertheless, this holiday is drenched in blood and sorrow, which is solemnized in the ghetto, now penetrates my heart. December 1942. It dawned on me that today is my 15th birthday. At 9 p.m., we met in the kitchen. People are already sitting at the tables. Here we sit crowded together. Until late into the night, we sang with the adults, songs that tell about youthfulness and hope. We have demonstrated that even within the three small streets, we maintain our youthful zeal. We have proved from the ghetto there will not emerge a youth broken in spirit. From the ghetto will emerge a strong youth, which is hearty and cheerful. Yitzhak and others were taken to Ponar Forest and shot in mass the first week of October 1943. Prayer nurtured the spirits of so many when all seemed hopeless. Convinced that no Jew would survive the Holocaust, Dita Siegel considered it imperative to record Jewish prayers, so she stole stickers from ammunition boxes at the Samarita camp. With no knowledge of Hebrew, she phonetically transcribed the prayers as she heard them. She said, "There was a woman, Clary Kana. She prayed all day and night. I listened to her prayers and I wrote them down. So if we die, they know that Jewish women had been there. I sat next to her all night writing."
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm Gary Markowitz, chairman of Holocaust Museum Houston. Today we remember the millions of Jewish people who lost their lives during a time of unequaled depravity and inhumanity. As the son of two Holocaust survivors, it has always been very important to me to recognize the uniqueness of the Holocaust and the special responsibility to ensure that the Shoah is never forgotten. As we witness with great sadness the loss of many Shoah survivors, the duty of remembrance is shifting to our generation and to those that follow us. Today we pause to remember the victims and say Kaddish for those who died so tragically in the Holocaust. It is our ongoing responsibility to honor their sacred legacy. Sadly, we also remember those survivors from the Houston community who passed away this past year and whose names are mentioned in our program today. May their memories be for a blessing. We are truly honored to have with us several of our community's Holocaust survivors, and today we celebrate their courage and message of hope. Please, if you are one of Houston's survivors, stand or raise your hand and be recognized. Thank you. Their stories are a testament to the ability of the human spirit to overcome the darkest horrors and the determination to keep the lessons of history alive for succeeding generations. This is central to the mission of Holocaust Museum Houston, to tell of humanity lost, of resilience and survival, and to teach tolerance, courage, and respect for human diversity. In remembering the Holocaust, we pay our respects to those who resisted, sometimes losing their lives doing so. There were those who resorted to physical acts of resistance by fighting in the ghettos, the concentration camps, and the forests. And there were those who resisted spiritually by maintaining their humanity and sense of civilization in the face of Nazi attempts to dehumanize and degrade them. In many cases, the very act of survival in the face of extreme circumstances was a form of resistance. As Yehuda Bauer wrote, "We respect every act of defiance, whether spiritual or physical, that gave the Jewish people dignity and humanity in the most humiliating and inhumane conditions." At Holocaust Museum Houston, we're dedicated to teaching the lessons of the Holocaust. It is our duty to counter the rising tide of anti-Semitism, bigotry, and hatred that threatens the values we hold dear. We are proud to have with us today the winner of the 2017 Holocaust Museum Houston Yom HaShoah Scholarship, Derek Wall. Derek is a student at Stratford High School and is also a member of the museum's Engines of Change Student Ambassadors Program. Derek, could you please stand and be recognized? Now I'd like to ask the entire class of Engines of Change to stand or raise your hands and be recognized. We at HMH are very proud of this program that introduces Houston area high school students to Holocaust history and enables them to better understand current issues and perspectives and to develop their own informed opinions and voices. I'd like to thank the Jewish war veterans from Houston Levy Post 574 for their presentations of the colors today. Also the Yom HaShoah Committee, the service participants, the teen volunteers, and the sponsors listed in your programs. In particular, we're grateful to Bill Morgan for his funding of this service in memory of his parents and brothers and sisters who perished during the Holocaust. We also extend our appreciation to Rabbi David Lyon, cantor Dan Mutlu, and everyone at Congregation Beth Israel for their assistance in today's program and for the reception following the service this afternoon. On a final note, I appeal to you as a society that it is our collective responsibility to confront anti-Semitism, including those who tried to deny the Holocaust. We must take a stand against all forms of prejudice and help build a world that is more accepting and free of hate with respect for all human beings. Thank you for coming today.
Another young survivor of Auschwitz recalled, in our barracks, there were young people from Greece. Daily, we would pray together in a corner. This bound us together, closer. At Hanukkah, we were able to procure a candle. On the first night, we gathered near the lowest bunk and lit the candle. It kindled new hope in our hearts for a better future and strengthened our faith. Longings for the past were aroused in us, a past when each observed Hanukkah in our parents' houses joyously. But that past has disappeared. There awoke within us a persistent plea. It burst forth from the depths of our hearts for the still distant future, when our prayers we chant will be fulfilled.
Hunger was one of the grimmest aspects of the Holocaust for its victims. It was severe, constant, and relentless, a black hole in the body that offered no respite. Recipes were always handed down from mothers to daughters. They capture the family, community, and geographic traditions. To maintain vestiges of humanness, women in the ghettos and camps wrote recipes on any scrap of paper that could be found, risking their lives to steal it away in any way they could. And when no paper could be found, they shared their recipes with one another. From Veli Kohn in Auschwitz, after a day of work, we returned to the barracks. We were very tired, and I wrote about food. What somebody said was best. We ate with our thoughts. I recorded what others said about food, their recipes. I wrote on whatever I could.
From 17-year-old Selma, in one of her 57 poems, she hoped to give to her boyfriend. Both perished, but the poems survived. Tragedy, the heaviest weight of all, to see that no one needs me, to know, to think, I'll fade into nothingness like smoke. And I want to live. I want to laugh and give comfort, fight battles, love and hate, hold heaven in my hand, be free to breathe and shout, I don't want to die. No, no.
And from Pavel Friedman, who also didn't survive, one most of us know, the butterfly. The last, the very last, so richly, brightly, dazzlingly yellow. Perhaps if the sun's tears would sing against a white stone. Such a yellow is carried lightly, way up high. It went away, I'm sure, because it wished to kiss the world goodbye. For 7 weeks I've lived in here, penned up inside this ghetto. But I have found my people here. The dandelions call to me, and the white chestnut branches in the court. Only I never saw another butterfly. That butterfly was the last one. Butterflies don't live in here, in the ghetto.
Oh, Elie Wiesel wrote, "In the dark years of World War II, there was darkness everywhere, in heaven and on earth. Today, we join Jewish communities throughout the world as we light 6 yard site candles. We remember those from our own families and those who have no family to mourn them. We are forever grateful to the members of the armed forces who liberated the camps and made sure the world learned what had happened. In those dark days, where could a Jew go? To hide or to hide your children meant living in constant fear. Lucy Baruch would light the first candle for those who hid and the non-Jews willing to hide them. Lucy Ehrlich Baruch was 2 years old in Warsaw when the Nazis invaded. At first, her parents thought that only her father, Nathan, a prominent attorney, was in danger. He hid, leaving his wife, Sarah, Lucy, and her sister, Yael. But soon, they realized they were all in danger. Nathan came back just before the Nazis forced them into the ghetto. They were able to escape just before the liquidation. For the rest of the war, the 2 little girls remained in hiding, separated from their parents and from each other. Although young, Lucy understood that she could never reveal that she was Jewish. First, she was hidden with an abusive family, then with the nuns, and later with a loving couple, Zofia and Arthur Zalewski. After the Warsaw Uprising failed, the Nazis expelled the survivors. They marched for miles and then spent days crowded in cattle cars. Lucy's parents, in hiding, were betrayed by the Nazis. Her father sent to Buchenwald, her mother to Pawiak camp in Warsaw, where she was killed. Finally liberated by the Russians, Lucy and the Zalewskis began the long trek back to Warsaw in freezing weather. Mr. Zalewski died on the way. At the end of the summer of 1945, Lucy and Yael were finally reunited with their father, who had been liberated from Buchenwald by the Americans. He remarried another survivor, and they lived in Warsaw until 1957, when her father was able to move the family to Israel. Lucy married Yitzhak, a mathematician. She's worked as a computer program and later a psychologist. As we light the first candle in memory of her family and in honor of those who hid. Ruth Brown had a happy childhood in Dusseldorf. Her father's family had been in Germany for generations. When Hitler came to power, life changed completely for 8-year-old Ruth, her older brother Claude, and her parents, Fred and Erna. Her father sold his jewelry store and everything that the family of 4 owned, and they escaped to Barcelona. But the Spanish Civil War erupted, and her parents sent 11-year-old Ruth to friends near Zurich, and her brother to an orphanage nearby. The children were there for 2 years with almost no contact from their family or each other. The family finally escaped from Europe on the very last boat to leave Europe for New York before the outbreak of war. The rest of her extended family all perished in the Holocaust. Her brother joined the military and participated in the D-Day landing on Normandy Beach. Fluent in several languages, Ruth became a translator for the United States War Department, and she witnessed the war crimes trials in Nuremberg. A lifelong opera lover, Ruth will light the second candle in honor of those who helped raise the spirits with music and art. staying alive, just staying alive and giving hope and courage to others was another form of resistance. Jacob Eisenstein will light the third candle in memory of his family and in honor of all those who against odds live to bear witness. Lighting with Jacob will be Chick Havey, who was a liberator of Dachau with the 42nd Rainbow Infantry Division. Thank you, Mr. Havey. Mr. Havey earned a Silver Star, 3 Bronze Stars, and a Purple Heart. Jacob was born in Tomaszów, Poland, one of 5 children. Soon after the Nazis invaded, the family was forced to vacate their homes and their bakery. Taking only what they could carry, they went to live with relatives, but the following summer, all the Jews of Tomaszów were forced into the ghetto. Young Jacob was picked up and forced to work in a labor camp where he endured terrible beatings. After 6 months, his family managed to get him to return to the ghetto. But one day in October 1942, he returned from labor and discovered that his parents and his 3 sisters had been sent to Treblinka. Soon, Jacob and his brother Julek were sent to a labor camp and to the horrors of Auschwitz-Birkenau. By the end of 1944, the Allies were coming closer. He was transported to Kafferring, a subcamp of Dachau. And in the spring of 1945, the prisoners were forced on a grueling death march. Many did not survive. Eventually, the survivors were liberated by American troops near Munich. After the war, he was reunited with Rosa Bravdanek, the girl he had been in love with before the war. And in 1953, they moved to Texas, where Jacob established a construction business. Jacob will light the third candle in memory of his family and in honor of all those who against odds live to bear witness. The next candle will be lit by Lucia Joskowitz. Lighting with Lucia is Louis Gammon. Mr. Gammon was a liberator of Nordhausen and awarded the EAME Medal, World War II Victory Medal, and a Purple Heart. Lucia was born in Krakow. Life was good until World War II began. In 1941, her family was forced to move into the crowded Krakow ghetto. But that was only the beginning of their misery under the Nazis. In 1943, in March, the Germans liquidated the ghetto and the family was sent to Plaszów. Her mother, Peslow, deported to Auschwitz, her father, Jacob, taken away as well. And the following year, Lucia herself, taken in a crowded cattle car to Auschwitz, where she was selected for hard labor. From there, she was sent to a munitions plant near Dresden, and as the Russian troops approached, the surviving inmates, packed into cattle cars, were sent to Theresienstadt. After liberation, she found that her brother Saul, although very ill with typhus, had also survived. Lucia met Reuben Joskowitz, the only survivor of his family, in the Landsberg DP camp. They married in 1947 and came to Houston 2 years later. Lucia will light the fourth candle in memory of her family and in honor of all those who fought for freedom. Edith Bannett Jucker, born in Krakow, was not even 3 years old when Germany invaded Poland. Her father was in the Polish army. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Edith was born in Krakow, not even three when the Germans invaded. Her father was in the Polish army, and Edith and her mother, together with others, tried to flee to Lvov. But they were captured by the Russians, accused of being German spies. Some of the family group managed to escape and return to Krakow. None of them survived the Holocaust. Ironically, 3 years in the Gulag, two more years in Siberia, is what allowed Edith and her mother to survive together, enduring terrible hunger and cold. In 1944, her mother joined the Polish army. They returned to Krakow in 1945, while war was still raging. Edith went to school there, training in chemistry and as an esthetician. She and her mother tried unsuccessfully to leave Poland for many years, finally were allowed to leave in April of 1958. And in September of that year, at a cafe on Dizengoff, she met a young man visiting from America. 6 weeks later, she and Sigmund Jucker were engaged, and Edith came to the United States the next year. Edith Jucker will light the fifth candle in memory of her family and in memory of the 1.5 million children who died in the Holocaust. Before we light the final candle, will all the Holocaust survivors please rise and remain standing? We honor you today and every day. We promise that your stories will not be forgotten. Can their husbands and wives stand with them as well? Will the second, the third, and thank God, fourth generation, please rise? Will all the teachers, educators, rabbis, and cantors please stand with them? Will all of us committed to making sure that the lessons of the Holocaust are not forgotten please stand as well? Alex Pollock will light the final candle in memory of his family and in memory of the 6 million men, women, and children murdered in the Holocaust. Alexander Pollock is from Bosnia, Croatia. In 1941, his father was taken away, murdered in the notorious Janovic camp, the largest death camp in Croatia. The rest of the family forced to leave their home. Their Christian neighbor helped the family find an apartment where they could hide, helped them move to the Adriatic coast where the Italians were in control. But his mother was eventually arrested and murdered in 1944. Alex and his sister were imprisoned for a year in the Rab concentration camp. He was only 8 years old. From 43 to 45, after Mussolini was captured and Italy liberated, they joined the Yugoslav partisan forces, little children facing death and starvation. After the war, Alex served in the military in Israel and then studied chemical engineering in England. As we light the sixth candle, let us promise to continue the legacy of the survivors and to never allow hatred and bigotry to triumph. Please remain standing for El Mole Rachamim.
Mitzvah menucha nechona. tachat kanfei hashechina. Memalot kedoshim, kedoshim otehorim, kedoshim otehorim, kezohar harakia miri. Et nishmot acheinu b'nei Yisrael hakedoshim, hakedoshim v'hatehorim shenaflu lifnei harotzchim. Menishbichud homom. May Auschwitz, Majdanek, Treblinka, Uveshar machanot Hashemam, may Europa, Shenehergo v'nisrefu, shenisrefu v'nishchetu, v'nikberu chayim. Mechol misot, meshunot, meachzariot. Anachnu b'neihem uvnoteihem, acheihem v'achoteihem, nodrim tzedaka b'ad hazkarat nishmoteihem. Megane Tehei menuchatam. Lachen bal harachamim yostirem beseiter kenafam Leolamim. Ve'yitzror, v'yitzror hachayim et nishmotam. Adonai hon nachalatam. V'yanuchu v'shalom al mishkavam. V'nomar
Yitgadal v'yitgadash shmei Rabba, Belma divra hirte viamlich malchute. Bechayechon uvyomechon uvchayed chol bet Israel. Ba'agala uvizman kari vimru amen. Yehei shmei rabba mevorach leolam olmei almaya. Yitparach vishtabach vitpa'al vitkoman vitnase. Vit hadar vit ale vit alal shmed kudsha brichu. Leila min kol birchata v'shirata, tush bechata v'nechmata, damiran be'alma v'imru amen. Yehei shlama rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu ve'al ko Yisrael v'imru amen. Ose shalom v'imrumav, hu yase shalom, aleinu ve'al ko Yisrael. Bimru, amen.
Our community of survivors decreases each year, but their testimony remains. This past year, Elie Wiesel died, but his message continues to shape the lessons of the Shoah. He said, "We must always take sides. Neutrality helps the oppressor, never the victim. Silence encourages the tormentor, never the tormented. There may be times when we are powerless to prevent injustice, but there must never be a time when we fail to protest." And finally, for the dead and the living, we must bear witness. As we remember the victims and the destruction of the culture which nourished them, may we also remember these lessons that Wiesel and other survivors have taught us and continue the work of building and rebuilding Jewish life. Amen.
Hi, my name is Susie Ehrenstein and I am a second generation survivor. On behalf of the Yom HaShoah Steering Committee, we want to thank the Houston and surrounding area rabbis and cantors, our guest youth choir, third generation readers, Congregation Beth Israel, Rabbi Lyon, Holocaust Houston Museum, and the Consul General of Israel for helping make today special. Most of all, we want to thank our survivors. I especially want to thank you for coming today together as a community to honor those who survived and to remember the many who lost their lives during the Holocaust because of prejudice and indifference. Our annual tribute means more because so many of you are here today to help us educate the public regarding the signs of impending genocide and engage hearts to take a stand against anti-Semitism so no more atrocities will ever happen again. Please, when you leave, take a yardside candle to light this evening to remember a Holocaust, someone who perished in the Holocaust. We invite you to a social gathering and refreshments in the Wolf Tumen Hall. I want you to enjoy the rest of your day. Shalom.
Shout to all the world. Der so kein Mal als du gehst den letzten Weg, wenn Himmel bleiben, er verstechen neue Weg. Weil Proben wird noch unser Häus gewinnt, der Show. Es wird der Beut von uns und von dir seinen Dorn. Weil Proben wird noch unser Häus gewinnt, der Show. Es wird der Beut von uns und von dir seinen Dorn.